Oh, look, this is still there, isn't it?
That wall with all those lights and the windows. It's all the fake windows. They're all still there. I've been promised one of those.
Have you?
Mm. I use it as a you know, feature in my sitting room.
Pity about the workshop, though.
Now, I think our sleepwear was particularly attractive, don't you?
It was so cosy. You loved doing the bed scenes. Because it was all air-conditioned in there, wasn't it?
It was. Well, actually, it was freezing cold sometimes. I remember one day in the winter, they had all the heating turned off because we're doing a rehearsal day. And the next day, if the heating was on, the grid would crackle and make noises, so they would leave it off. So we're freezing to death.
That's why doing the bed scenes was fabulous.
Grabbing the blankets off the beds to try and keep warm. And I said, I've had enough of this, so I've got the whole the continuity girl's Polaroid camera and took a photograph of us all freezing. This went charging, having asked a number of times to have the heating put on and being refused. So I went up to the head office, to the general manager's office, straight past his secretary, flopped this photograph on his desk and said, "Here, your top rating cast, I'm freezing to death in these studios. This is your copy. The next one goes to TV Week." Bang! Heating was on 10 minutes later.
It was crazy, though, because we were always shooting outside broadcasts in winter in summer clothes. Then in summer, we'd be doing winter scenes.
Oh, yes, but we were a lot luckier than Holiday Island.
I was in Holiday Island.
Holiday Iceland.
In bikinis in that swimming pool. In the
eating ice to stop your breath from fogging.
Yeah, the tricks. But I have
no intention of letting you be idle until then. Now, I wonder who ended up with one of those lovely dryers. I believe the steam press ended up in a gay nightclub in Sydney. Probably been trashed. Great shame. I wouldn't mind owning that now. All you have succeeded in doing is making not to iron, as you understand.
Three and a half years. He only had 2 months to go when he broke out.
They've added on 2. Look at that skinny arm. There's no arm in it.
Chrissy, you've still got Elizabeth to think about. Keep me hopes up, you mean? Just to give them the satisfaction of saying I can't have her? Oh, the bastards. Mm. I'll show them.
She's up to no good.
Smith, mop and bucket.
The times we washed that floor.
Half a litre of cleanser and a scrubbing brush.
Oh, is that what they are?
I think she's up to something here. I've got this funny feeling.
Did you get under mouse?
Yeah, I know that, that look on their face. Bees, I'm talking about.
Yeah. Those two sweat.
You want a bet? When we finish with them, they'll be too scared to come within cooey of us. I want to show them what real fear's like.
They won't let us get.
It always looked like a small prison, really, didn't it? Because there were always the same extras.
What I thought was really interesting is when some actresses were asked to actually sort of mop a floor, you could tell they'd never done it before in their lives. Unlike me.
Oh, it's Mouse.
Yenta.
What a great little character.
It was a terrific character. That marvellous walk.
Do you know she started as an extra?
Yes.
And Sheila Florence, it was due to Sheila Florence that she got.
I didn't know that.
Yeah, she was telling me this morning. She's walking my dog as we speak. And she said, Sheila went to the writers and said, look, you watch her on screen, she's really good, because she had this fabulous little character, like a mouse.
Yeah, so she had a whole lot of mannerisms that went with the character that she put into it, like that fantastic walk.
She said she based it on Commedia dell'arte, Harlequin.
Oh, right.
In the beginning, when she had to be silent, it was all like a mime act. So that's a success story, because usually they say don't ever be an extra, because you never get out of being an extra. But there's one story that did.
Well, quite a few of the extras in prison actually ended up getting roles, partly because they were in the show for so long and they had named characters. And I actually, because I was Equity Dip, as you remember, saw a director directing one of the extras, and I said, excuse me, did you just tell her what to do? You just give her a direction? She's now an actor. You'll have to pay her full amount.
Oh, my God.
And jumped straight in. And they said, oh, well, I've got to, oh, well, okay, we'll pay them. So a lot of them got, well, if we're going to pay them, we might as well get in line.
So they got 50 words, yeah. Didn't they? They were known as the 50 worders, weren't they?
Barbara Youngworth is one of those people.
Is she?
Yes, she's one of those. True, but it'd be boring. Not that they credit me with it, I'm here
Betty
to tell you.
Betty Bobbitt. You've finished with your Laurel and Hardy routine. She was a great asset to the series. Hey, Jude.
Yes, and another strong icon for the gay community.
Yes.
She's actually, interestingly enough, her character, my character, and Frankie Doyle's character, Carol Burns' character, Frankie Doyle, were all based on one real person, but different facets of the one real person.
Oh, really?
Yes. And she actually did become a woman who ran the a halfway house and started it off herself.
Really?
Yeah.
Is she still with us?
I don't know if she's still with us, but we
did
met
her.
She came in on the set and we met her,
wow.
Yeah.
What, had she been inside?
Yes, oh, yes, she had, and she'd been top dog.
They start wow. imagining all sorts of things. She was the second lesbian character to come in, really, wasn't she, after Frankie?
Yeah, about the second lesbian character on television in the world, yes. Most likely. And there's... Was that Colette scrubbing the floor down there, Colette Mann?
It was too quick.
You should be with Smith and Bryant. They're trying the old scare tactics.
And you left them alone?
Oh, no, it's not. Yes, it is.
Yes,
it is. That's Colette's bottom. Uh-huh. These were two terrific characters together, Lizzie and,
yes.
and Doreen.
They were both like
they were
children.
Oh, great. Yeah, like little kids they were.
Smoking
oh,
again.
Oh, yes, puffing away.
You know, one of these days they'll give us some decent equipment.
Yeah.
Have you any idea how hard it would really be to nail a hole, make a hole in a galvanised bucket like that with a dick?
The noise alone would have brought them all running.
You need a sledgehammer.
Well, any more than two would be taking us inciting a riot.
Well, this is just some of it. The same things happened to all
we
the
did have fun, though, didn't we?
Oh, it was wonderful fun. Look at Fletch the Lech. He went to America.
Yes, he's still living in America.
He's still living there, writing, isn't he?
I think he's writing. He does a lot of voiceover stuff still. And he also is the leading light of a local small theatre company in Arizona because he rang me last time he was out to ask me about royalties, actually.
Uh-huh.
And I've got his address, and I'm going to be in Arizona later this month, so I might call in on him.
Mrs. Powell, I warned you about snap decisions. You have just played right into their hands, and all you have done is given yourselves more work.
Well, it's impossible to keep them under supervision as long as they're in pairs. We haven't got the staff to go around.
In future, I insist on everything being referred to me first.
Mrs. Davidson, it weakens an officer's authority to have to refer to you on every single detail.
This is episode... What,
195? You know, one of the questions that really used to irritate me in England when we were doing that tour is about the shaking sets. I mean, I threw enough people up against those corridor walls to know whether they damn well shook or not. And they're still there, apparently, because they were right up against the exterior wall, the interior wall, but of the actual studio, which was quite large. I think the only sets that ever... that did really shake if they were like Meg Morris's house or home or something like that. They were sets they sort of brought in and just constructed in the middle of the studio. But those walls that you can see now, I could hurl people up against them.
They were
permanent.
Actual.
And the doors were metal. You know, a lot of people think they were wood. They were actually metal.
Yeah, that's right. And we could do all sorts of things. We used to hang on to them and shake them, didn't we?
Particularly during that riot scene, if you remember.
It was huge.
We scared the living daylights out of the car, out of the crew, if you remember, when we did that riot scene. They were not expecting the level of energy. They took about three steps back.
It was very scary because at that time we had no stunt coordinators, did we?
No, we didn't.
No fight.
They had the very first fight that I had with Frankie Doyle, Carol Burns. They had a stunt coordinator in, and we just sent him home.
Yeah.
Because he had no idea how women fought.
We're worried about you.
Yeah, come on, Mrs. Barry. We can't look after you properly if we're locked in here. Why don't you let us out?
Joy Westmore. gorgeous woman.
Great comedian.
Very funny girl.
Yeah, very funny.
Very, very good actress.
Speaking of stunts, remember the stunt that went, the fight scene that went wrong and I broke your nose, as you keep telling everybody?
I know, well, it was wonderful. Her elbow caught the bridge.